Today we're recapping a horror thriller film, The Clinic. Spoilers ahead. The movie opens up with an aerial shot of a lone car driving down a road. The year is 1979, which is 6 years before the invention of DNA testing. In the car is a young couple, Beth and Cameron. Beth is pregnant and can be seen holding a Christmas card. She and her fiancé, Cameron, discuss the card meant for Beth's mom, with both of them agreeing that Beth's message on the card was terrible. She tells him that her mother likes him, but this joyful moment is interrupted by a careless truck driver who tries to run the couple's car down the road. Eventually, the car ends up on the side of the road with the duo breathing a huge sigh of relief. Cameron comes outside to check on the car, and Beth will join him in a bit. He tells her that they can't make it to their mother's tonight and suggests that they spend the night somewhere else. Back in the car, they drive down the road and enter a town called Montgomery, which has a population of just 532 people. They arrive at a motel, and Cameron jokes that he would get the best room, the presidential suite, he calls it. At the motel, Cameron meets Hank, the attendant, who takes a particular interest in Betty. Hank admires Beth's breasts, and even thanks God for her. As regarding price, he charges Cameron $105 for himself, his fiancée, and the unborn child, each person paying $35. Despite Cameron's shock that he has to pay an extra $35 for an unborn child, he decided to take the deal. At the motel's pool, the couple can be seen relaxing. Beth tells Cameron to feel the baby kick, and they proceed to make out. As this happens, a slightly older couple appear ahead of them. The couple speak in a foreign language, and the man stares at the couple suspiciously. Almost as soon as they arrive, the strange couple turn back to leave immediately. Beth and Cameron fall asleep, where Beth has a nightmare. In the dream, she sees her child crying so loud in a pool of blood, surrounded by Roman numerals. We discover that this isn't the first time Beth has had this dream, and her husband reminds us that it's perfectly normal to have strange dreams while pregnant. In the motel room, Beth expresses her fear of having another miscarriage. However, Cameron is confident she wouldn't. He adds that there is just a 3% chance that it could happen again. He assures that her daughter would be healthy, smart, and beautiful. With her mind at peace, the couple lie down to sleep. Before we go on, like the video, smash the subscribe button, turn on that notification bell, or Slender Man will haunt your dreams. A few minutes later, Cameron leaves a message for Beth, telling her he went in search of food. Back at the reception, the attendant is watching TV. Cameron's unable to find a restaurant still open, and he decides to drive back home. However, as he gets into the car, he discovers that he's out of gas. Left with no option, he walks back to the motel room. But back in the room, Cameron realizes that Beth has disappeared. Worried, he goes to Hank's office, which is closed already, and the pool. But Beth isn't in any of these locations. It's 4:06 a.m., and Beth is still nowhere to be found. Cameron calls the police, and a bald, middle-aged officer, Marvin, arrives to help. Marvin goes to Hank and asks if he's seen Cameron's fiance, Beth. Hank isn't helpful, and this causes the officer to interrogate Cameron even more. Due to how insensitive the questions are, Cameron gets angry and he attacks Hank. However, this scuffle is quickly disrupted when Marvin beats Cameron until he becomes unconscious. And just as the scene is about to end, we hear Hank appreciate Marvin for saving his life. In the police cruiser, Hank tells an unconscious Cameron that the motel checkout time is 10 a.m. and tells him that his wife would be found sooner or later. Now, in the next scene, we discover Beth is in an unidentified room. She's in a bathtub filled with ice when she wakes, and she discovers that her baby had been delivered through a cesarean section. She stands from the tub and picks up a cloth placed on the chair in the room. On the cloth is written the Roman numerals DCV111, just like the one in her dreams. Outside the room, Beth discovers that there are several other empty rooms like hers, meaning that there are other victims like her. She calls for help, but nobody responds. Beth eventually finds her way out of the hallway, only to emerge in a large abandoned warehouse. Despite the size of the warehouse, nobody appears to be in sight. Crying, she runs away from the large factory, Unfortunately, her escape becomes unsuccessful when she discovers a large gate bolted from the other side. She bleeds at the spot of the operation and falls down from the growing fatigue. As she slowly passes out, three young women in a similar situation arrive beside her and debate whether she's alive or not. Back at the police cruiser, the police officer tells Cameron that he's in real trouble. He tells him that the judicial system in his town is very slow, suggesting that he would spend days behind bars before he even goes to trial. At the factory, the women have taken Beth to be one of them. While Veronica, one of the women, covers Beth's operation wound, Ivy discusses how they can escape this strange warehouse. The last of the women, Allison, doesn't speak, and Veronica confirms that she hasn't said a word since she was found. Suddenly, the women hear a strange muffled sound. They follow the sound and end up in an empty room. Except it's not completely empty. Right on the floor of the room is a long line of blood. These women follow the trail of blood, eventually arriving to see another woman with her intestines out. She pleads with them to save her baby, who she calls Blue, and gives up. Meanwhile, Cameron escapes from the policeman after hijacking his car and cuffing him to a pole. The women back at the warehouse discuss their babies and surviving. While Ivy wants to leave immediately, Veronica and Beth say they wouldn't leave without their babies. Allison also nods in agreement, and all the women go back in to find their children. At the entrance to the warehouse, the women divide themselves up. Beth goes with Veronica while Ivy and Allison form a team. In a tiny office, we see two individuals watching the women's every movement. Cameras have been installed all around the building, and these two watch on a number of small monitors. Ivy and Allison discover an abandoned camera. Ivy wants people to believe Allison when she tells her story, so she takes a picture of her and places the camera on her neck. At the same time, Veronica and Beth discuss Ivy, causing us to discover that Ivy had been raped. Veronica adds that she was torn between having the baby or having an abortion. As they slowly advance, they realize that this procedure has been done to several women in the past, as there are hundreds of images to show this. Allison, now separated from Ivy, arrives in a room filled with flies. While in here, her lantern breaks, and she's murdered by an unknown individual. Just before she dies, she cries for help, and the other women run to her. Allison, now dead, is surrounded by the other women. Veronica places her hand inside Allison's wound and picks out an item, one which none of them is able to identify. Fortunately, Allison took a picture before she died, and it showed that she was murdered by a woman, another mother. Cameron is still trying to find Beth. He goes to Hank and smacks him across the face, asking for his fiance. After a bit of torture, Hank explains that a certain woman asks if there are pregnant women at his motel, adding that she takes them to an old abattoir outside of town. Back at the warehouse, the women discover that the Roman numerals are a sequence. Allison was 605, Ivy 606, Veronica 607, while Beth was 608. Ivy finds formula bottles for babies, a discovery which leads them to finding babies in another room. The babies are placed in padlocked cots. And also, due to a lack of proper identification, the women are unsure of their own babies. Beth eventually finds out that the tags inside of them bear different colors, colored tags which would only match that of their children. She also suggests that the mother who died earlier had seen the color tag inside her, which explains why she called her child Blue. Consequently, this creates a major problem for the women. It means that the mother killing the women is trying to find the color tag of her child. However, she's not willing to tear herself open for the tag. Instead, she wants to kill the other women and find out their color tags, leaving her own tag untouched. This way, she would be able to discover her own baby without touching her wound. Veronica suggests a surgical removal of the tags. She tells the women that she woke up in a room filled with veterinary surgical tools. Again, as the women leave the room, we see the same strange individuals watching them through the monitors. Cameron also drives towards the location Hank shared with him. Unfortunately for the three mothers at the warehouse, they're chased by two hungry dogs. This chase leads Veronica and Beth to fall into a ditch and become unconscious, while Ivy hides inside a container. Simultaneously, Cameron suffers a tragic car accident that kills him immediately. Later that night, Veronica and Beth wake up in the ditch, and Veronica informs her that she'd been having a nightmare. Veronica is quick to offer a medical diagnosis for the dreams. Beth explains that she's always seen all of these in her dreams, She also tells about her miscarriage 2 years ago, before suggesting that they try to climb out. Due to a dislocated knee, Veronica is unable to climb out of the ditch. As soon as Beth does, she leaves to find something that could be of any help. Similarly, Ivy comes out of the container and walks around the cow shed in a bid to escape. In an unfortunate twist of events, Ivy is murdered by the same mother who killed Allison. Still looking for something that could help Veronica, Beth arrives at an abandoned mobile home, where she finds a framed image of a woman. Outside, she sees a strange man bring the body of Ivy in a wheelbarrow. She hides immediately as he makes his way into the trailer. Inside the trailer, the man, Duncan, sees Beth and cowers in fear. He tells her that women aren't allowed in his house, and this could get him in trouble with Miss Shepherd. After taking a piece of candy from Beth, Duncan reveals that the place is run by Miss Shepherd, and all he has to do is clean and mop the floor. When challenged with questions from Beth, Duncan runs away. But a fast and desperate Beth catches up with him and grabs a bunch of keys from him in the scuffle. Beth goes back to Veronica after finding two small cages, which she used to get out of the ditch. Now out, Beth tells Veronica about the key she found and the death of Ivy. After walking for a few miles, the women stop at an abandoned car due to Veronica's fractured leg. Suddenly, another car charges at him, but the women escape by a few inches. We then discover that the car was driven by the crazy mother who gives them a hot pursuit. They arrive at a room filled with surgical tools. Immediately, Veronica lies on the table and proceeds to cut herself open for the tag. As this happens, the crazy mother bangs at the door. Suddenly, the light goes off in the room, and Beth goes out to find something that could help. During Beth's absence, the woman attacks Veronica and stabs her in the neck. However, before she's able to make her escape, Beth attacks her, and a fight ensues. As luck and strength would have it, Beth stabs this crazy mother, and then tries to save Veronica. But she isn't able to. As she's about to breathe her last, she tells Beth that her color tag is yellow. The crazy mother disappears, causing Beth to go and search for her. She finds her in a restroom with her stomach torn open, trying to find her color tag. The woman confessed that she was told to kill the other women because this was the only way to find out which child is hers. However, before she dies, the crazy mom makes Beth promise that she would take care of her child. Beth promises, and then takes the tag from the now-dead mother. Still, the unidentified man and woman continue to watch Beth through the cameras. Excited that she finally discovered all the colors, Beth runs back to the room the babies are in. Unfortunately, the babies are gone. As she cries and laments in the room, the lights go off and she's attacked by a number of unknown people. The scene blacks out immediately. Surprisingly, Hank and Marvin, the police officer, carry an unconscious Beth out of a bus with her hands chained in the next scene. Later, Beth wakes up chained in a living room with Miss Shepherd and the foreign couple she saw at the motel. A contract is underway for the sale of her baby, and despite her screams and cries, the foreign woman takes the baby. Miss Shepherd explains to Beth that she's the first substitute mother to survive the C-section and subsequent events. She boasts that her facility allows prospective parents to evaluate the mothers of these children before adopting. While Miss Shepherd speaks, the foreign man appears beside Beth with a gun pointed at her head. He adjusts his aim and promises Beth that her daughter would have a good life with him. Just as the man is about to shoot, Duncan appears with a gun behind him. Unfortunately, the man is faster than Duncan, shooting him right in the head. But as his body drops to the floor, his finger pulls the trigger, killing the foreign couple in the process. Immediately, Miss Shepherd picks up the baby and runs out. Beth escapes the chains and goes in search of Miss Shepherd. Instead, she finds her baby in a room, while Shepherd appears behind her holding a file. She explains that Beth's parents, Roger and Judy Church, had actually adopted her from her biological mother, Lydia Hayes, through this same method. She adds that her father could not legally adopt a child due to his criminal records, causing him to pursue an unconventional method. Beth shoots the gun, only to discover that it's in fact empty. She then attacks Miss Shepherd and stabs her in the stomach with a key. The police arrive and Beth discovers that Cameron, her fiancé, is dead. A few months later, Beth and her baby visit the cemetery and stop at the gravestone of Lydia Hayes, her biological mother. She notices a flower at the gravestone and asks the cemetery attendant about the man she saw on her way in. The attendant explains that that the pregnant wife of the man went missing years ago, adding that he lives on the other side of town. Thinking that this man could be her father, Beth walks into the town in the direction the attendant pointed. This was a review of The Clinic, which was produced by Samuel Pinchuski. It featured stars like Tabret Bethel and the late Andy Whitfield.